My name is Royston Robertson. I'm a freelance cartoonist and I draw cartoons for Private Eye, The Spectator, all sorts of magazines, anybody who wants cartoons, basically. I've been a cartoonist, really, I think as long as I could hold a pencil. I was always the kid at school who drew cartoons. I drew for the college magazine and the school magazine and so on, drawing professionally since about the late 90s, early 2000s. Well, as a kid, it was just things like the Beano, the comics, really, you know, that's where the passion for, you know, jokes and funny images came from, you know. And then as I got older, they became Viz Comic, and then I got into Gary Larson's The Far Side, and then I started reading things like Private Eye and so on as I got older, and I realised they needed people to draw these cartoons, you know, and send them in. So I just literally, you know, one year made a New Year's resolution to start sending them off to magazines regularly, and soon started getting published, and I was away. So the key is to keep it still fairly loose. I think a lot of people, when they do digital drawings, there's a tendency to overwork them and they put on all kinds of fancy gradient effects and stuff. But I always try and make it look like an ink drawing. The appeal of cartoons to me, I think, is that they sit amongst all the other stuff in life, so all the serious stuff. You open a newspaper, you've got a little cartoon there. It's a little bit of fun or a little bit of anarchy in the middle of everything else. For me, the perfect form is the joke cartoon, where you've got just an image, usually with a caption underneath it, preferably one that can tell a sort of timeless joke and can live on or comment on the day's news or whatever. My first cartoon, I think, was published in Maxim magazine. So this would have been in about 1997, because it was when the Blair government had just come in, or just about to come in. And I don't know if you remember, there was the slogan, New Labour, New Danger. Well, I did a cartoon, you could probably visualise it yourself, which was New Seekers, New Danger, which took the very famous 70s pop group and used them in the cartoon. Unbelievably, Maxim magazine went for this cartoon. And so that was the first, my first sort of proper published one, other than things like school magazines and so on. As a cartoonist, if you start thinking you're important, then you're in trouble, you know. But I think they are definitely a vital part of daily media mix that we have, you know. I think it would be a real shame, obviously, a lot of print markets are going, I think it would be a real shame to lose the cartoons as well. And they do work particularly well online anyway, I think, you know, certainly in social media and stuff, because they're like memes that are so popular. A cartoon is a very similar thing. They're the original memes, you know. The weird thing about this story is it just sort of came out of nowhere. So everybody's now doing coronavirus cartoons. We didn't even know what it was a couple of months ago, you know. I find as a cartoonist, you're thinking all the time, really. It's very difficult to switch off, you know. You're watching the news and you're listening out for not just the actual stories that are happening themselves, but the way people are talking, what the buzzwords that people are using, anything new. But then beyond that, you're also doing that when you're down the pub with people and when you're going around having the tea with your kids, you know. You're always thinking about things that people are talking about. Because it's not just about, you know, topical isn't just about the news, it's about, you know, the way that we live now, you know, which changes all the time. You know, the zeitgeist, as they say, you know, that's what you're always trying to capture. I think in about 2016, I bought myself an iPad Pro, and I'd been doing digital work up to a point in that I used to draw on paper and then scan them into the computer and then colour them on screen. So I was kind of half digital. And then in 2016, I got the what they call the iPad Pro, which was the top of the range one. And there's a program on it called Procreate. little bit of a pun there. And a lot of people have said to me, "Oh, this is like a game changer, really. You know, this is the one that, you know, you can draw on it just as easily as you would draw on paper." And I thought, well, I'll give it a little while. And I was thinking I'd probably, you know, give it 6 months, ease myself into it. And I found that within a couple of weeks, I was drawing completely digitally, and all my work was done completely digitally. And so I can draw on the iPad and email cartoons to markets, you know, anywhere in the world. So that's a big change. It pains me to say so. Brexit has been good for cartoonists. It's been a subject that's provided lots of jokes over the years. Brexit and related issues surrounding it, you know. And I think actually, if you speak to the Private Eye magazine, they'll tell you their circulation has gone up since Brexit and Trump. They're one of the few magazines that is actually bucking the trend, because people want humour about these, you know, devastating subjects, you know. There's certainly, the past few years, there's been no shortage of subject matter. in the news whatsoever. Because I'm primarily, I do what I call gag cartoons or joke cartoons. I don't do caricatures that much. So that's not as big a part of my work as one of the guys on the political cartoonists on the newspapers. But I do them as and when is necessary. But often it'll be, you know, two blokes down the pub talking about what's in the news. You know, you're not always necessarily caricaturing the people themselves, but unavoidably, people like Boris and Trump, you know, they're a gift for cartoonists, so they do creep into the cartoons. Part of the reason for me with going digital was I wanted to make sure they looked the same as they had done previously, and I was only going to start sending to magazines. Digital cartoons, once I knew that they looked the same as my inked cartoons. And actually, that, you know, a lot of people didn't even know that I'd made that switch, so that was a successful thing for me. You try not to use too much of the digital technology because you don't want them to look overworked or too computer generated, I suppose, you know, because they're not computer generated, they're still drawn by hand. This just replicates the effects of ink on paper. So I wouldn't say it's changed my drawings visually in that sense, but it has made things a lot more efficient. You know, you can correct things very quickly. You can copy and paste things if necessary, and it makes the drawing process easier. A little bit of alcohol stimulation can help, but you don't want to go mad, because once you start doing stuff that you've thought up when you're three sheets to the wind, it's normally not that good the next day when you look at it. What I tend to do is I'll sit down with pen and paper. So when I'm brainstorming ideas, I'll just sit at my desk with a sheaf of paper and a pen, and you know, look at what's in the news. Sometimes you're putting two stories together, and try and get it to the stage where you've got the idea worked out before you go to the iPad to draw the actual cartoon. The most important thing is the idea, definitely, the joke itself. I mean, if you look at magazine gag cartoons, a lot of the time the drawing itself can be quite rudimentary, but as long as the idea is good, that's the most important thing for this type of cartooning. If you've got a beautifully drawn cartoon, but the joke doesn't really work, then that doesn't, you know, that's not as good, really. So really the idea has to carry. Humour does change all the time. Some things you can say now that you couldn't say then, and vice versa, you know. All I think that the internet has done has accelerated it. I've no idea what colour the coronavirus is, but you tell people you're a cartoonist and you've never met before, they are always, you know, very interested, and they want to know about it, and they will fire a whole load of questions at you. Because also the idea of, you know, cartoons is a very broad thing, so people may know that you mean, you know, gag cartoons for magazines or whatever, or comic strips, or they may think that you mean the Beano, which is not something that I do, and they may think that you mean animation, which is not something that I do. So it's a very broad area, so there will always be a whole raft of questions as soon as you tell people that you're a cartoonist, you know, which is fine, you know. I'm very lucky and very privileged as a cartoonist to be doing something that I enjoy doing, you know, and it's always different, you know, the new stories come along, and you know, new ideas, new concepts in the news, and you're responding to that all the time. So there's always something new, there's always something different, and you're trying to make sense of it all and make it into something humorous. I do feel privileged to be able to do a job that I enjoy doing, and it's always, there's an end product at the end of it. You've created something that you can look at and say, I made that, and other people will look at it, hopefully laugh, and you've done your job.